This is Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and we're out here in the middle of July in a total drought, a severe drought for Wisconsin. We have never seen this in our lifetimes, so we thought we'd take you on a little walk around the yard. One of the highlights of this time is the sunflowers. These are planted by themselves in the fall. I just take off some of the heads and stomp them into the ground, and the squirrels do the rest. And these are not being bothered by the drought, although they are very early.
And they're not as tall as full as they usually would be, so
yes,
you can see the difference.
Some of them get to be 12 feet tall. Obviously, I'm 5'9". They are not anywhere near 12 feet this year. But they are happy and they are open, and we are thankful. But if you look behind us, you can see the grass. Now, this grass would normally, in our yard, be a luscious green. And there is a sprinkling ban for the city of Brookfield. You can sprinkle your lawn on the day, the odd or the even days, but even that has been cut back now, and you can water your vegetables and your trees and your flowers, and that's about it. So our ground cover, which is normally, it's a sweet woodruff, which is usually green and luscious, is now crispy. New trees coming up by themselves, and weeds are no problem. These are our burning bushes that would in the fall be beautiful and red.
I think they're burnt.
I think they got crispy. Yep. So that's sad. You see, even the trees are starting to get crispy on their leaf ends. They're burning just from lack of water. And we did have a whole week of 100 degree temperatures, which just fried everything. But
and this is a new maple tree that we put in last year.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
We're gonna have to get some water on there.
This is one of the trees that we cut down two springs ago. It's sprouting up from the roots. Obviously, this one is not being harmed by the drought and probably is very happy that I'm not out here every day chopping it down, but I'll get you. These are the milkweed pods that we leave for the monarch butterflies. Thank you. Now, I have cut them down because I don't want them to go to seed, but normally these would be almost this tall, and I only cut maybe a foot off of them. So they're suffering, but not too badly. We've noticed as we drive around the countryside that places that have native plants growing in them are faring far better than city lawns.
That was amazing, driving through the countryside, to see the vegetation so green yet.
Right.
And even the trees, although a lot of trees, their leaves are drying up and falling off already.
Yes, they are. Yes. Unfortunately, the farmers now have permission to use the streams and lakes to irrigate their farm crops. So I don't know how long that will last. These are really tough perennials, almost to the invasive point. They are just, they look like they...
Talk about wilted.
Yeah. Wow. Usually these flowers would be this long. Here it is. That's it for the flower.
Amazing.
There's not many of those.
No.
Now, we were told that the grass is dormant and that all we need is a good rain and it would come back. It's sort of like it's in its winter state, but it's summer. Now, something that has done well, and this area is really, really dry, is rose mallow. Mallow plants are really tough, and they will blossom. These are finishing their blossoms. These are the seed heads. But they're tough. The sedum is tough. This is tickweed, which is an annual flower, but it seeds itself and it continues. They're tough. But again, they're native, so But the sedum is holding its own. But you can see the sedum has the thick leaves that store a lot of water in them. So they have stored up and they are surviving and blossoming. But they too, those should not be blossoming yet. They should not blossom for probably another month.
Well, look at all your mums that were blossoming weeks ago already. Yep. I've never seen that until maybe the end of July, August, somewhere in there.
Exactly. And these, usually these would be this tall. And I would have to cut them in half to keep them compacted. There's my poor hostas up here, which, yes, they shouldn't be in the sun. But this is far earlier than normally would, you know, get crisp like this. And they've already had their flowers, which is, that's unheard of also. This is a little lilac bush. Desperately needs some water.
It's amazing.
Yep. Now our plants on the other side, and the tropical plant that we bought, just as a specimen, is fine because we have watered it. We consistently water it every other day. And our river birch are fine because we water that. That is a Cleveland pear. That's good. And, you know, the different bushes that we water, great. If we didn't water them, they would be looking like those hostas. Now, this hosta is doing well, but it is shaded almost all day under this beautiful maple tree. But the ferns, which eventually would be falling over and drying up, are gone far sooner than they should be.
Now that's a couple of months early.
Yeah.
Yep. I think we're ready for snow.
I think at some points when it gets almost to 100, we're hoping for snow. We have to watch movies that have snow in them just so we feel cooler.
Die Hard 2.
There you go.
Airport.
How about that one, a zebra, something zebra. And the,
Ice Station Zebra.
There you go, a perfect summer movie.
At least psychologically you can feel cool.
Echinacea, tough plant. Again, it is under the shade, but doing well. And our bee population is good. There's some more hosta, and yes, they usually do crisp up, but again, too early. Then there's the raspberry patch. This is just heartbreaking. They started out so well. They were so bountiful, we couldn't even walk through them. And we were able to get a couple of quarts, couple of pounds picked, and then we got hit with 100 degree weather. And the next time we came out to pick, they look like they're little raisins on the vine.
They look so sad.
I mean, that is just pitiful. Yeah. And the ones that are here, that they're so sour, you just don't even want to eat them, and so seedy. So our next great hope is our blackberry bush, or vine. We need to water this some more, but you see these are luscious fruits. Hopefully the Japanese beetles won't get them and the birds won't get them before we do, but it's loaded, it's happy, it's spreading along nicely. So thumbs up to you guys, tough as you are. And our blueberry bushes, unfortunately, also are suffering. There's a blueberry. It looks like a dried blueberry. Look at that. It's like a blueberry raisin. Let me try it. Off. Whew.
Wow. And we watered these too.
Yep. Look at that. They're all
right
shrunken.
Up. Yep.
That's too bad. We were hoping for a good crop. Now our grapes, so far, are okay. There are not as many as there were last year. There are some, and hopefully we'll be able to get some and make some grape juice. But again, you know, the weather is the thing. I mean, if you get your soil correct, then you have to rely on the weather. And if Mother Nature is not working for you this year, you suffer. Let's take a look at the North Garden. This is where we have the majority of our tomatoes. We also have our zucchinis and our squashes. Again, we water here. We water every other day. Yesterday we had about 100 raindrops. We were all dancing and cheering. Yay, we got rain! But that was about it, 100 drops. Zucchini. Oh, this actually is a Zeppelin squash. This one is seemingly doing quite well. Here's a Zeppelin right here. Doing nicely. But we water. Eggplants seem to love this weather. Oh, there's the dreaded Japanese beetles. There they go. Yuck. And you can tell on the few little eggplants that we've had so far, they've had nibbles out of them. These are green peppers, looking kind of wilty. But they are producing. Tomatoes on the vines, yummy. Wonderful. We have to keep watering them though. We have to consistently water them. Otherwise they're going to end up with blossom and rot, which comes from inconsistent watering or lack of calcium. So you spread your powdered dry milk around the base of the plant and you water on a regular basis, and hopefully that'll take care of that.
Could you use crushed clamshells or, you know?
I suppose if you had those available to you, but it's very easy just to sprinkle dry milk on it. It's more available to most people. And that's because it kills the funguses in the ground. These are our garlics. I don't want to pull them out, but I may just leave them in there and let them go through the winter and grow up again. These are our green onions, which actually are doing very well, and it's coming to the end of their time, so I'll be pulling those out. Rhubarb, way too early for that to be looking like that. Asparagus, I think, is doing quite well, actually. These we planted just this spring, a little roots. And look at our poor cucumbers. These are supposed to be lemon cucumbers. There's a little one here. I know we've never grown them before, so I don't know if that's the size they should be, but the plant itself looks just awful. Yep, there's another one. Another sunflower. Squirrels planted this one. Zucchini. This one has been attacked by squash borers, so I do have diatomaceous earth around its base. But it continues to provide blossoms and fruit. Same with this one. Now we're in the middle of the day, so you don't want to water these right now. They will be watered this evening. But there's spaghetti squash. This is our watermelon. I don't know if we're ever going to get any watermelons if it stays so dry, but there is a flower there. Come on, watermelon, we're rooting for you. And then these are our butternut squash.
I've never seen our butternut squash so tiny.
No.
That's pathetic.
Yep. Now, on the other hand, this is lovage, which is in the celery family. I have chopped this down twice. This is a perennial. It's an herb. It would be this tall if we hadn't chopped it down, but it was in my way, so I chopped it down, and then I chopped it again because it was just getting way out of control. These are moon lilies. Unfortunately, they're poisonous, if you try to eat the flowers. But the flowers are huge. They're like this long, big trumpet, white trumpet lilies. They're absolutely gorgeous. Gorgeous. And they have their seed pods look like little sputniks with prickly little pokers coming out of them. They grew here last year by themselves, and I did sprinkle some seeds. I never thought they'd come up because we mulched, and now I've not watered these at all. They are supposedly annuals, but we had a mild winter and now we're having a hot summer and they seem to like it. Unfortunately, another of our Wisconsin industries has really been decimated by this drought, and that's the apple and cherry crops. This apple should be about this big by now. And there it is. It looks like a prune.
I hardly see any apples on our tree at all.
There's hardly any.
Or pears.
There were lots of blossoms
in the
spring. It was lovely. But we have no pears this year at all. It could be the off year, which, you know, is possible, but usually there's a couple that have just come out anyway. We look at the grass here, which we never have watered throughout the whole summer, and you can see it's gone. And this is good compared to some places that you see people's front yards, areas along the highways that are within the city. It's just brown, so we hope for rain. Now, not all of Wisconsin is like this. If you go farther south by maybe 100 miles, it's fine. If you go west, it's fine. If you go north, it's fine. It's just this one little part here in southeastern and southwestern Wisconsin that have had no rain, well, since the beginning of June, except for the 100 drops we got yesterday. But we'll keep you updated, and we haven't given up hope. We'll still have some crops, but it's different. Bye for now.